Good afternoon again. So we are David and Sascha from 1&1 Mail and Media. And we hope you are well prepared after lunch for the afternoon sessions. And we start today with Caught in the Hype Cycle, a project review about the things that we've seen and the obstacles that we had during our project phase. And just first, a few words about us. So my name is Sascha Mühlbach. I'm since 6 years at 1&1 Mail and Media. I'm responsible for the infrastructure architecture and started together with David working on the Kubernetes project in 2016. Just a few words from your side.
I'm David Meda-Maroeli. I'm originally a physicist and turned to the IT like some 15 years ago. I'm nearly 12 years with 1&1, and in Mail and Media I'm now for about 4 years. I'm an architect as well. My focus is everything that's connected with automation, and in the next couple of minutes we'll talk about automation and other things that we encountered on the way to a cloud-native world.
So, but before we start with the topic, just a few words about our company. So United Internet is one of the European leading internet companies. We have more than 9,000 employees, nearly 100,000 servers in different data centers, different product lines, access hosting, of course, and Mail and Media, that's our division, so where we provide email services. I think many of you know web.de or GMX, the famous free mail providers in Germany, with more than 30 million accounts. But we also have other products beside the email. So we also have the email, for example, which is the digital signed email. We have an online office, and that's in fact one of our first products that was built for the Kubernetes environment, and it's entirely running in Kubernetes. So you can edit your documents and your tables there. And we have also cloud storage, which is a product where you can upload videos or just pictures from your smartphone or any other data that you have. Well, the organization itself, so where we are working, is the IT department or the operations department. We have a classical structure so that we currently in the transition from Zelos to DevOps, but for now we have a separation between development and ops. We have around 25 teams working for development, just for the mainnet media department, not for hosting and access. So it's roughly 300 developers working on all the portal pages and applications around that. And we have 10 system administrator teams that are working with the hardware, working with these systems, with the applications on site, doing the 24/7 on-call, and all that what belongs to IT operation. And with Kubernetes, we did actually start the project from the IT operations department. So it was more the IP operations guys that said, okay, we want to do something new. That sounds interesting. It seems that it fits very perfect to our automation strategy. So let's start with that. And so we also created a new team in our operations department for this Kubernetes project. Well, as we are a company that has, we can say a long history. We of course have a lot of software artifacts that are already there. We have nearly 1,000 different software artifacts, applications that do various things in our environment. And we run more than 15,000 instances. So half of them are virtual, half of them are physical. We have a very high automation degree, so we have 95% Puppet coverage in our environment, because otherwise we can't handle that with the staff that we have. We have around 80 administrators working on that, but you can't do 15,000 servers without a high degree of automation. We have 3 data centers where we host our stuff. We have 2 in Germany and 1 in the US, because we also have a small brand in the US where we also do webmail and cloud storage. And because we are so long in the market, we also have a couple of languages in our stack. So we have, of course, Java, which is nowadays the primary language, but we also have PHP. We had Python in the past, but now it's getting again more important because of all the big data stuff that we are doing. Then we have C++, because we've written our own mail server. And of course, we also have the JavaScript things for the front end. So in 2017, going back to the early days in January, David and I just, it's better so? Ah, okay. So going back to 2017, David and I just thought about, okay, how we can create a architecture vision of what the new Kubernetes platform should look like, just incorporating all the demands that we have from our past experience. And then we came up with we call it the architect's vision of the end of end-to-end automation. So on the left side, we have the developer or the product manager with a product idea. And the idea is that whatever the developer writes in Java or whatever language, together with a descriptor, can go through a pipeline directly towards the Kubernetes infrastructure, where the entire product setup is then done automatically. So we use Helm, Ansible, GoCD, and of course Jenkins for the build pipeline to finally deploy an application into our Kubernetes cluster. And it also automatically creates network configuration and load balancer configuration, so that in the ideal world, with a single statement up front, we can create a public available web product directly within a couple of hours. So that's what was actually the idea. And of course, because we are coming from IT operations, there are also a couple of expectations that we had, our own guys had, the people from development have, and of course our management also had some expectations if we start a new platform. So flexibility is one. What we definitely want to have is that we have instant availability of compute resources. That what's all the cloud people, propose, and that's what the management also expected from us. Of course, arbitrary scalability, well, that's, you can achieve it if you have arbitrary scalability in your data center, but of course, data centers have walls and there's some limit. We also have the rule that we don't use public cloud providers because of data security, so we had to do it all with our own data centers. So there's some certain limit, of course, but the idea is to have it virtually scalability. Of course, efficient operation, that's very important for us in IT operations. So whatever we do or whatever we build, it must be nearly 100% automatically operated so that the day-to-day operation doesn't cost any manual work. And of course, we also have strong security requirements, just because of the sensibility of the data that we have. We have emails from customers, data from customers, so also security is very important. And finally, we have also demands on availability, so that's why we use 2 data centers, at least. And we also need to create a platform or a Kubernetes platform that reflects all these availability requirements. So multi-cluster, multi-data center, active-active replication, and all that stuff. Yeah, and
Okay.
Finally.
That looks like quite a lot of expectations and quite a lot of functionality. I'd say this is totally exaggerated. To me, that looks like we are jumping right into the Gartner hype cycle. Exactly like this. No, this. Okay, doesn't jump just one page. Okay, so we are somewhere in the peak of inflated expectations. And let's look what actually happened when we built that. 6 months later, the ship looked about like this. A large ship, lots of Kubernetes servers, lots of stuff being available, but essentially no containers. Oh, no, wait. There was one pilot application, at least. And then we started talking quite intensively to people in our company and said, why aren't you using that marvelous, shiny platform and the deployment pipelines and all the stuff we built for you? And we found out, yeah, people were interested. I would actually have liked to, but they didn't know how to use it, actually. Some said, okay, we took the effort and learned how to use it, but we found a couple of features missing. Like, we started building a back-end cluster, but they had front-end applications which need to be in a separate cluster with separate network zones, and we hadn't built that yet. And then a very special thing happened that's sort of typical for administrators, for sysadmins. I said, okay, this is new. I don't really trust that yet. Because, you know, my service runs at 99.99999% availability or something like that. And I don't trust that new platform to deliver that for my service, and I don't want to make my service worse than before. So this was an interesting experience. And in the end, at least we had some users. It was the team that actually runs the Kubernetes clusters, and they moved the entire Puppet infrastructure to Kubernetes in the meantime. So they were actually not only having a big benefit from that, they also were proving that the platform is running smoothly. But the rest of the organization actually dropped into the trough of disillusionment. So we that was somehow the point where we discovered we are somewhere in the middle of the Gartner hype cycle and it works, you know, like it's expected to. So let's have a little look what actually happened and what prevented people from using the Kubernetes platform. The first thing that we had in mind when designing the platform was security. Because we are offering services for like 40 million people, and we need to think of the security and safety of their data. So we designed everything essentially paranoid. We have, for example, very, very strict pod security policies. In particular, you are not allowed to run anything as root in a container. You are not allowed to have additional privileges except the most basic ones. You're not allowed to write into the container layer, so the containers are essentially read-only unless you configure a volume that's particularly writable in a particular directory. The consequence is that most images that you get at Docker Hub just don't run, because they are not configured and built like that. So we had to teach people additionally, you know, how to build their custom images and follow a couple of rules so they matched these policies. And that took some time. And then it turned out that there are some use cases which just need, for some reason or other, well-argued reasons, additional privileges or write privileges or something like that. And, well, we did a couple of exceptions, but these are pretty painful for the users because we have them argue in depth why they actually need, I don't know, cap net admin or something like that as a privilege. Okay, so security was a thing that hit people pretty hard, but we are not willing to reduce security. Another aspect is complexity. going back to our vision, that looks pretty simple, pretty easy to use, everything's fine, isn't it? But if you zoom in a little bit, it looks more like this. And actually, we forced people to use GoCD for deployment, for example. This was a new system, so they needed to learn how to use it. And it's a very powerful system, but it's also very complex. And building an architect's vision like we showed it always adds some complexity somewhere, and it reduces complexity at some other points. So there's a certain entry threshold for using that system. We tried to counter that a little bit, or reduce that a little bit, by standardizing as much as possible, allowing for using templates and stuff like that. But even then, it's not that simple. On the left-hand side, you see the configuration screens for a new pipeline in GoCD. And it was actually 12 of these screens you would needed to go through, at least for the first pipeline you build. And you see these red boxes mark everything where you need to put in values that configure the pipeline. This was a little complicated. And fortunately, we were able to provide new templates based on a YAML configuration format that is actually reducing that to like 50 lines of code, which is significantly sort of less than going through the web interface. What's more important, you can use that and template it. So your second and third and fourth application look just the same, and you just need to replace the application name. So that helped people a lot. So it doesn't look as pretty, but it's very usable for sysadmins and developers.
Another thing that was problematic was our separation between the network zones. So we have front-end and back-end clusters that David already said. And we actually started with setting up the backend clusters because it was a little bit easier because we don't have to cover the external reachability. But finally, the developers and operators said, OK, it's good that you have the backend cluster, but we now want to start with frontend applications. Well, actually, it's not that we have not asked them before, but they just changed their mind. So we had to set up the frontend cluster as well. And with that, there comes another difficulty, because then we need to set up SSL certificates to SSL offload or for the load balancer configuration. And then we started with an SSL configuration that had a single SSL certificate. And then the next guy came and said, OK, well, that's not enough. I want to have 30 SSL certificates in a single configuration. So we needed to adapt our Helm charts and all that stuff as well to that new requirement. And that's just an example, but there are a couple of those little things that just came into the mind of the people when they sit there and write the code. They just weren't able to see this before, but then, of course, we need to react. Another thing that there was making some problems was this double NUT that was introduced by our infrastructure, which had a external load balancer for the for the load balancing, and then we had the Calico inside the Kubernetes cluster, where we also have a source NUT translation, which leads to that the application finally was not able to see the caller's IP address, and some of our tools rely on that. And so we originally thought it would be able to rewrite the applications, but that was more difficult than expected. So of course, we had to fix that in the platform. And then we just replaced, in the for example, in the backend systems, we replaced the combination of an external load balancer with the Kubernetes balancer, and only use software load balancing in combination with MetalLB to remove one of these steps. And another thing that's also something which comes from our history, we share our IP address space all over the United Internet companies. So there's a tool, it's called DIM, and it's a tool that's internally written, and whenever you request an IP address, you need to request it there. And that's one step where our nice automation idea breaks, because that tool wasn't able to provide an API. So we weren't able to really push the application from the developer to live without a manual intervention. So the developers had to write a ticket and get an IP address. Some administrator needs to manually pick up the IP address, write it in the ticket, and then it needs to be published. So, but I think 2 or 3 weeks ago, we just removed that problem and now also have a fully automated IP operator inside Kubernetes that fixes this last manual step.
Okay. Networking wasn't the last issue we encountered. External software. Of course, we use ready-made software or commercial software in places. They come usually as Debian packages or Red Hat packages, and we need to squeeze them into containers somehow. Sort of like this. But it turns out it's not enough just unpacking them in some base images, because most of this software doesn't come, you know, as a microservice 12-factor like app, which is essentially what a Kubernetes platform is optimized for. So these applications want to log somewhere, they don't have space for logging, they want to have local disk caches, they want any number of things. And to get rid of that, or to at least, you know, capture the log data streams and moving them somewhere useful, we need, in many cases, we just need to repackage everything they deliver. This is a lot of manual work, and people, that's new to people, so we needed to actually do a lot of training for developers, training for sysadmins, and support them whenever they got stuck somewhere, which is quite often, actually. I touched logging and monitoring. This is important because many of the, you know, old paths aren't available anymore. It's in container environment, it doesn't make sense to log to local disk, which most existing applications actually do. Alerting is sort of the same thing. Historically, alerting went through the actual server on the actual instance of an application, but autoscalers create any number of application instances, and it doesn't matter if a couple of them might not be running. So alerting needs to look at the total service availability and not to the single pods or containers. So there's just a couple of things that changed. Sort of, it looks like it's subtle, but it's difficult to handle if you're sort of, you know, started in the old world. So this gets an award. This is the award for the most underestimated topic when moving to containers. And we also underestimated social aspects. There were situations when our sysadmin sort of went demonstrating and said, okay, you are taking everything away from us, like everything. This is not working like that. And the other thing was, you know, they had to move, they had to learn new things, they started with exaggerated expectations. So we had to do some expectation management, which we started way too late. So it was more effort, you know, to get people back on a realistic view of things. And of course, using a DevOps-like pipeline, as we showed before, needs changes in attitude for many things. And it takes not only training and people talking to people, but it takes just time and patience. That's very, very important. Take your time. People get used to new things, but it takes a lot of time to accommodate that in your daily doings. So slowly we went on into the next phase of the hype cycle. Anybody got an idea what that is? Next phase in the hype cycle? Okay, I'll show you. This is the slope of enlightenment. People sort of got enlightened, got trained, got used to things, and slowly but certainly got happy again with what we provided to them.
Absolutely. So, finally, to summarize a few of the important success factors, you can change them in non-technical and technical. So, of course, as David said, training, consulting, all that things where you need to explain your IP people how to work with that, to operate it. It's time consuming and it takes time for them to learn it. They need to have time to work with the platform. However, during that time, it's very important that you be there to support them. And that's also one thing we have learned from that project. We originally started with a group of volunteers that said, okay, we think that's interesting, but we just learned that we definitely need in that phase to get out of that through of disillusionment, you need to be there and you need to guarantee a certain amount of support. So we just created a new team for writing and supporting the developer experience in that case. Of course, expectation management is important. The new technologies always promise things that you can do with that. They always promise that they are easy, that they are simple, that you don't need to know what's inside. But in fact, if you operate that things, David showed this picture with this difficult machine inside. Yeah, it's actually like it looks like Sadi. You need people that understand what's happening inside, especially if there's an incident. On the technical side, definitely one thing that we're still on track and we're still, but caused also a lot of work is unifying things. So we need to standardize the images, we need to standardize the ways things are getting deployed, because that makes it much more easier to write documentation, to help people if you know what they are doing and they know what the platform is providing. And as I already said, helping all that with a dedicated team of people is a really high value for the entire project, because it gives the people that are working with the platform the good feeling that there's somebody there that can help them. And if you just invest and keep on focusing on those success factors, then Gartner promises that you will reach the final stage, and that's the plateau of productivity, where your project then really generates value for the entire company. And then from our perspective, it's absolutely worth to take the effort. We now, and that's 1.5 years after we've launched the platform as being available, we now have 70 of our applications running in Kubernetes. It's the online office, as I said. We also have the entire spam scanning engine for WebD and GMX running in the Kubernetes cluster. We scaled our cluster across the last year by a factor of 3. We now have 15 clusters with more than 360 physical nodes. And we replaced several hundred virtual machines just by using those Kubernetes infrastructure. And this is also something which helps our infrastructure team, because with VMs, they always had the problem. They had a full OS. They need to patch them. When there's a kernel issue, they need to patch the entire set of VMs. They need Puppet for every host. They need monitoring for every host. And all that, it's now gone, because we use the Kubernetes infrastructure. So we can say the ship is sailing, and it's now the first one is fully loaded. We are still expanding. We are now expanding on a quarterly basis. So we expect that by the end of 2019, there are at least 100 applications more coming to the cluster. And we are now also working on things like Istio service mesh integration, where Stefan and David tomorrow will also give a talk on our progress there. Now I thank you very much for your attention, and of course, I think we do we have some time for questions?
Hello. Thank you for your talk. Do you understand me?
No.
Should I talk louder? Louder? Better? Okay. Thank you for your talk. I would have a question. Would you go by smaller scale if you could do it again? If you could reword the hype cycle, would you choose a smaller scale to begin with?
Well, that's a really good question. We've asked. We actually did that 1 year before that. So we had a small project where we just did it with one application. We've built a small cluster for only one team, but we just found out quickly that we are losing too much of the values that the people are get known to in our existing environment. So that we said, okay, when we start something like this, it needs to feel like our existing platform, and then it's not an option for us to start with something small, because then, for example, geo redundancy would be missing or multi-cluster would be missing. And yeah, so we had no other chance than to start with the big picture from our perspective, yeah.
More questions?
Yeah, hi. My question would be, you said you are using a classical approach and migrating now to DevOps. What is the reason for that, and how are you doing this?
Obviously, as a company that's like 30 years old, we started like in the classical mode of having development teams and separate operations teams. But as most of you probably know, there's walls building up between them, and processes, especially when handing things over to operations, tend to get very tough, tough and rough, and it's slowing us down. And now with also the tool set available for full DevOps modes, people start seeing the benefits they have from that. The benefits of being able to deploy quickly, to work closely together, to handle all the requirements like in a single approach and a single effort, and not building the applications and fixing the ops problems later. So people start learning that, and this is essentially why we want to transition to that. But with 1,000 running up applications and like 300 to 400 people working on the tech business, that's not a one-off effort. You just need to give it time, start here, move slowly. So we are prepared for a pretty long transition phase. More questions?
Hi, Lucas from GameForge 4D. I've seen in the bigger picture that you have Jenkins right behind your GitLab instance for building. Is that correct? And if yes, why not using CI/CD from GitLab? Or is that legacy and planned to change?
That's actually already changing. We started with a sort of 100% build queues or build pipelines in Jenkins, sort of historically, when we didn't have GitLab yet, even. Yeah, we have Jenkins for quite a while. So when we started with the project, GitLab CI wasn't that popular or that powerful. But right now we are seeing more and more people starting to use GitLab CI for building their stuff. That's not on the slide yet, but we have it available for people. Actually, it's that if you want to build containers, you need to do it currently in the GitLab CI pipeline. So people are slowly moving away from Jenkins. Nevertheless, a lot of the existing stuff still is in Jenkins, and so that's still the majority of applications.